white circles are the plates that can be served.
joins late, then you will say everyone is drinking from the left glass. So you don't realize that this left-right symmetry exists. Okay. On the other hand, the opposite could also have happened. The first person could have randomly lifted up the right glass. And then everyone would have to lift the right glass. Alright? So what happens is that though the initial system had this symmetry, when you come later, you don't see this. It is there, but it has disappeared. So this can be there is no symmetry, and this beautiful example is due to Abdul Salam. I promised to show you a picture, I'll show you another one later. And this is Salam in his young days, when he actually. And this actual, this beautiful example was presented by Salam in his Nobel lecture. So I'm copying it from him. Okay, the point is that if it's not one table with people sitting, but let's say it's a big affair, beer buddy, many tables, lots of people. So let's see, so it's an ensemble of systems. So many, many tables, people sitting at all of them. Now what do you expect? In some of them, people will pick up the left glass. Some of them, people pick up the right glass. So if you make a survey over all of them, then again it is 50-50. So what has happened is that the symmetry has moved from an individual system to the ensemble. So it's got hidden. If you are sitting at an individual table and you don't bother to look at the other tables, then the symmetry is hidden. So it reappears on the ensemble. Now, let's take another example. Take a ferromagnet and cool it below the Curie temperature. What happens? You all know that above the Curie temperature, see the Hamiltonian, look at it, is a dot product. So it's invariant under rotations. However, at above the Curie temperature, the domains are all going in random directions. So there is no specific direction. But when you cool it below the Curie temperature, all the domains get aligned in a particular direction. So the rotation invariance is lost. You have a particular direction. So in this case, I've drawn the arrow as some particular direction. So now, if you are a little fellow living inside the ferromagnet, you take your little magnet meter and you look at it, and there is a directional space. So there is no rotation invariance. You've lost it. Okay. On the other hand, has the symmetry been destroyed? No. If you consider an ensemble of ferromagnets, different ones, the domains will get aligned in different directions. So I've drawn some possibilities. And essentially, if you take a large number, you will see that all the directions are possible. So on the ensemble, it's still there. But on the individual system, it's lost. And notice to take this. You saw, I told you about phase transitions a little while ago. And this kind of thing is always associated with the phase transition. So at high temperature, the symmetry exists. At low temperature, the symmetry disappears. That is, low temperature means you're near the ground state for the individual system. And in between, a flip occurs, which is called the critical temperature, and that's where you have a phase transition. And so, but if you are a little fellow living inside the one of these systems, then you see the phase transition as a change in the nature of the things surrounding. So the physics seems to change. So this idea is explained by Sidney Coleman. And so if the person sitting inside the system is called Coleman's demon, you have heard about Maxwell's demon. So similarly, it's Coleman's demon, who lives inside a ferromagnet and can't find out and looks and has a rotation invariant Hamiltonian, but doesn't have a rotation invariant physics. Now how does the superconducting phase break the new one? So by phenomenon, and we will discuss the relativistic model, which is due to Ambert-Rao things and so on. award for this skill. So there's a real scale of things. Okay, in a real superconductor, you would model this by not having, but you would have a condensed post-condensate of Cooper pairs. Okay, but now we are looking at a relativistic toy model where you replace everything, all that, to replace it by a scalar. Okay. Now, in addition to this, this is not enough. Let the scalar field have a self-interaction term. So this is basically a five-fold term. In some strange way. So now you can look upon this one. This is the gauge field. This is the kinetic term, and this is like kinetic term minus potential. So think of it as a gauge invariant potential, these two terms together. So I'm writing them on the next slide as minus V of phi, where V of phi is this. Okay? And this phi star phi, I'm just writing as mod phi square and mod phi to the fourth. Okay, so this is charge scalar field. Which now, how we modeled it, there is a charge scalar field inside, it has a mass, it also has a self interaction. Okay. So let's plot this potential as a function of mod phi. So simple, there's a square term and there's a power 4 term. So in the beginning, it will behave like a parabola and it will grow more sharp when you go to higher energies. So there's the minimum, clearly at phi equal to 0. Mod phi 0 means phi is 0, both really make it faster 0. So that's fine. So there are no symmetry broken. So this is your normal. So no big deal. But now imagine you make a little modification to this thing. What do? You take a little variation and change the sign here. Okay? Remember? Sign here like this. Okay? So I'm changing, make a modification, making this sign plus. If I do that, of course, now if you treat this as a mass term of the number, you will get an imaginary mass. My square changes sign, I think mass becomes imaginary. So then you will have a tachyonic field. We don't want that. So we don't try. We just let this be an interaction term. So the potential now has this form with a negative sign. Okay? So let's find the extreme of this. So take the negative extreme to 1.5, you get 1. And then L squared takes the derivative, you will get this solution. It's easy to understand this. Because let's take this graph. See, what will happen is that you have minus L squared, phi squared. So if I didn't have the other term, how would it go? It's an inverted parabola. It should go down. Then, when phi is small, phi squared dominates over phi to the fourth. As phi grows larger, not phi, then phi fourth will start dominating, so then it will start going up. So you have this particular shape. And remember, this is mod phi. This is happening in mod phi. So then there's also a phase of phi. So this whole thing is like, this upturned thing is like a circle. So it's really like the bottom of this bottle. Okay? So imagine the bottom of this bottle has this little thing on top. And there. So all these are the minima around it. And it's like a circle. So, now, this is the case for symmetry brain. So the symmetry is there, okay? Circle is there. However, all of these are possible ground states, okay? If I look at the bottom, all these states at the bottom are possible ground states. However, system can have only one ground state. Okay? System settles in equilibrium, they can have only one ground state. So if there is only one ground state, let's say only one point of this is the ground state. Okay? The moment that one point is chosen, it's like choosing one direction in space. It's like one person picking up the glass. So the symmetry gets spontaneous. Okay. So now, how do we handle this? The moment you say only one, you've got it. So now, let's make the mathematics a little simple. See, I have the freedom to choose these axes in the phi space. Okay. Now before the symmetry got broken, how I will define my phi? Real and imaginary parts is up to me because I can make rotations. That's the gauge invariance. started sleeping? No. Because let's find out one direction has been picked up. So this is the Lagrangian in the neighborhood of the Dirichlet. It's like what you would do in the Carolingian below the Curie. So this Lagrangian has already the symmetry and got hidden points. So let's calculate the terms one by one. Let's do this d nu phi naught plus phi prime. So d nu is del nu plus I e mu. The del nu will act on phi prime. And then you have two terms with I e mu and phi prime. And I will find out. So three terms like this. So it follows that if we have the product of two, so I've written this and the star of this. Okay, straightforward. Multiply them out. So, okay. Okay. I just the star I have taken inside. So the signs change. Now, we can multiply all the terms, but I am trying to point out to you these two terms. The A mu and the A mu B. Suppose we multiply them out, what will you get? E squared, so minus sign plus sign over there, E squared, not squared, and then mu. Remember, last time I wrote down yesterday. So now you can say half m photon squared is E squared phi naught squared. So that means that inside a photon, the potential as we assume here, the photon becomes massive, here is the energy, root 2 times, that is 10 and half, E phi naught. And that you could write phi naught replaced by d by root 2, so you get E. Okay? So because this vacuum expectation value developed, because the vacuum is no longer at zero, but at some other value, you have got this. And notice that the V, remember, was this. So the lambda is sitting inside this. Without the lambda, you couldn't have this. So therefore, this mass of the photon is a manifestation of the self in scalar self dimension. You could take both of these. N squared and lambda are both set in scalar set interactions. So both of them have contributed to giving you the mass. So that's how inside a superconductor, if you have this kind of field, you get a mass. Another miracle happens. What is that? Now the mass term we took for the scalar was negative, right? So the scalar was either massless or tachyonic, whichever way you want to put it. Not physical. Okay? But now, so this is the potential, okay? Here is the wrong sign as well. It should have been positive. So now I'm plugging in all of this, okay? I plug in the new fields. So much better, okay? So do some multiplication here. You will just do that. You will get sum of phi and phi stars. You get the real part of phi prime. Okay? So collect the coefficients so that you will find them like this. And therefore, so phi naught squared is n squared by 2 lambda. Plug that in here, and you will find something interesting. This term cancels. Only this term survives. So this V, the leading term of the mass, this is clearly a mass term, is the real part of phi. The imaginary part of phi, the mass term of that, this term is zero. So what have we got here? So you could write this as some mass squared. And notice the sign has changed. This one is now positive. Remember, it was negative here. But after the symmetry is open, when you do the calculation near the ground state, the mass has become positive. So this scalar has given you a real scale. It's a real physical scalar which has a positive mass. And that mass, of course, is M. So it's related to phi naught, which is given mass. So both the U1 symmetries are broken, of course, both global and local. But that doesn't matter because you are near the ground state, you know it's broken. So the real part has a real mass, and the imaginary part is massless. But a massless scalar is always a problem in a theory. Why? Because it will mediate long-range interactions. In a superconductor, you don't want long-range interactions. You just want all the things inside to be zero. So the Goldstone, this is called a Goldstone boson, and this is a problem in the theory. It turns out that with every spontaneously broken continuous global symmetry, they correspond to massless boson. This is one manifestation of it. This is known as the Goldstone theorem. Okay. And of course, we can't get it. This Goldstone boson, we have to get it. So, as I wrote, you can induce non-local long-range interactions, and you don't want it. You don't have the Goldstone. Well, here's a picture of Jeffrey Goldstone. So, suddenly, he should have shared the Nobel Prize with the others. But choose a case here, make a case transformation. I'm allowed, right? Because the gate symmetry is not broken. The time is. So let's make use of that gate symmetry and parameterize it by putting some e to the I theta here. So we've done that, right? E to the minus I theta, that's the gate transformation I wrote yesterday. So now you have e to the I is I minus e theta. And now I will say that after I know the gate symmetry is going to be broken. So I don't mind choosing a particular gauge. It's going to be broken anyway, I might not choose a particular gauge. Okay. So if I do that, then what's the good choice? What would be a good choice? For theta? Just do it to make this 0. Okay. So choose it like this. 0 and then this just becomes the real field. This particular gauge choice is called the unit. So in this case, chi of x is simply eta of x. The Lagrangian becomes very simple. You have d mu eta minus beta. Beta has a simple form. Eta is modified, right? And you would still have symmetry breaking. All of that will constant still is f by root 2. So eta becomes shifted f by root 2 plus eta prime. This will lead to what? A mass for the photon, which is half n gamma, where n gamma is ED. This potential, the leading term, will now become this. So the heat mass of the eta is constant, and there is no Goldilocks for this. If he had kept the xi, it would have been reversed. Now I made a great choice for the xi, it disappears. Okay, so no Goldilocks. So this beautiful thing is called the Higgs method. But you may ask the question, that doesn't this look like magic? So we have degree of freedom, how did it disappear? Okay, so it must be there somewhere. So where does that be? Yeah, that's very interesting. See, the unit ring is the photon is massive. Okay. A massive photon has 3 degrees of freedom. 2 transverse and 1 longitudinal degree of freedom. And the extra degree of freedom, this longitudinal polarization which appears, is at the cost of the disappearance of the Goldstone degree of freedom. So what we have done is we have basically reparametrized our fields in such a way that now what used to be the Goldstone boson in one formalism is now looking like a longitudinal polarization of the photon. And you can actually work out details that show that they couple in the same way. Okay? It is actually the longitudinal polarization. It is the Goldstone boson. It's just changed its form. So, one fancifully says the photon swallows up the Goldstone boson like a python swallows an animal whole and becomes a massive object. So, the long thin python has become this fat object by swallowing up the Goldstone boson and becomes massive. And this is known as the Higgs method. So the English like to call it the Higgs mechanism. On the continent, this is all relevant now because of Brexit, the continent would like to call it Brout-Omelet Higgs mechanism. But anyway, I think Higgs mechanism is easier to say, so I will continue to say that. But we should give proper credit to the others. Okay, let me introduce you to the people here. So Robert Brout and François Anglais, they wrote actually their paper came out 1 week before Higgs. And Robert Brout unfortunately passed away in 2011, 1 year before the discovery of the Higgs boson. And Peter Higgs, as he used to be when he wrote this paper, he's still alive. And so is Anglais. And these people wrote a paper which came out 3 months after this. Okay, but in those days there was no internet. So you didn't get journals for 3 months. So it took, so they discovered it independently. Guralnik, Hegel, and Hewitt. However, the Nobel Prize was owing to these two very happy looking gentlemen. So this picture was taken, this is Anglais and Higgs as he looks now. And this picture was taken in CERN on the day when the Higgs boson discovery announcement was made. So this eta field is the Higgs boson. And this basically what I've done to you, if you look at Higgs's paper of 1964, I would basically repeat what was done there. So it's very nice paper to read. And he pointed out, so why is it the Higgs boson and not the Brout-Anglais Higgs, Hegel? Why not all those things? Because the others pointed out how you can get rid of the Goldstone boson. It's only Higgs who pointed out that this remaining eta field will be a massive scalar which you should detect in experiments. So that's why it's called the Higgs boson. So in that sense, Higgs did one little bit more, and that is one in thing.
And this particular thing was suggested to him by Nambu, who was the referee of the paper.
Yes. So piece of paper is missing, right? So I have also heard another story that it was Ben Lee who was the mystery. So you see, part of this is legend. So
most of these things are actually repeats even in the constant literature. Anderson actually corrected this.
So, yeah. So you had stepped out at that moment, so I showed Anderson's picture and I said in 1950.
Oh, sorry, Anderson.
So actually starts from Landau Ginsburg, 1937.
Right.
And then Anderson extensively applied to plasma in 1963. Anderson missed the second Nobel Prize because in his, I read his paper on plasmons, at the end of which he says, however, these things are unlikely to apply to hydrogen physics. Within a couple of months, he said, they are unlikely because of the electricity model, they are unlikely to work. And within a month of that came the Gural Day, the Amulet Brown paper. So by that one statement, Perkin now missed the second Nobel Prize. So at that point there was a problem which I did in the tutorial. I'll explain this in more detail. But he says that I have hit upon a desperate remedy. It had turned out to be the right one to save the exchange, whatever. And namely the possibility could exist in a nuclei, not in the nuclei, but electrically neutral particles that he wanted to call neutrons, we call the neutrinos today, which have the spin half and obey the fusion principle and so on. And the mass should be very small. In fact, this is very present here. And then you could understand. So dear radioactives, examine and examine. Now, he was sure that people would really give him a blasting for proposing a new particle. So in those days, people were very nervous about proposing new particles. It's not like today, when you can happily propose an infinite tower of new particles and no one will complain. But in those days, even one new particle, and people would complain bitterly. So Pauli actually didn't dare to face this audience. So he gave this completely lame excuse that there is a ball on the right of 6, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, 7, So let me go ahead with this now. That's probably as it used to be in those days. Later, of course, he grew it back. The reason why this became serious was Pauli, not people didn't really take him seriously. If you read George Gamow's 30 years of physics, which shook physics, there's a play at the end of it, which was performed in Copenhagen. The whole purpose of the play is to ridicule Pauli's theory. Okay, it's very funny. So, anyway, but Pauli is cast as the devil, and Bohr is cast as God. And it's an interesting thing to read sometime. But 1934, Fermi is the first guy who took this neutrino idea seriously. The name neutrino is also due to Fermi. You can understand, it's a typically Italian. Small neutron, neutrino. Well, so what did Fermi say? Okay. He says, let's take beta decay. And earlier, people wrote it as a neutron, but it was a proton and an electron. But let's also add the neutrino. It's actually turns out to be an antineutrino. But that's a matter of which came up later. Let's add this. In that case, the interaction should be like this. I showed you yesterday what decays should be on the neutron, and then decays to the proton, electron, and the neutron. So, as a first try, this decay must take place through weak interactions. Why? Because the lifetime of the neutron is like 8×10⁷ seconds. So, yesterday I showed you the typical lifetimes, and only weak interactions can give a lifetime of this order. So, it has to be a weak interaction. All right? So the question is, can we write down an interaction vertex space? So the first attempt is Fermi, I'll show you that. where does this become maximum? When cos theta is minus 1. So therefore, the tendency will be for the electron and the neutrino to come out back to back. How do you find it? So basically, you look at the neutron at rest. You'll have a proton and electron coming out. Now, the two momenta will not balance. There'll be some missing momenta. So then, of course, by calculating those, the total momentum should be zero. The momentum is zero. So therefore, whatever is the remaining is the electron. Now you look at the angle between the neutron and neutrino and the electron momentum. So you should have the maximum number of events according to this theory. Well, they are back to However, when people actually looked at the data, they seem to come out in the same place. So there's something wrong with this. Okay. In fact, if you had plus here, that would be right, right? Because then so it should be zero. So within the same direction. So I should have a plus here. Okay. So finally, it's second effect. He said instead of right, exactly the electromagnetic interaction, put a gamma mu. See, you're trying to discover a new interaction. You just do tentative things, you see what fits. So put a gamma mu here, and then you get this form. This is like one current, like an electromagnetic current, So this is called a current form. Hadronic current with the proton neutron, electronic current with the electron and neutrino. This is the current form of the weak interaction. So you do your calculation, and now what you get is 1 plus cos theta, and this fits the experimental data much better. So Fermi went ahead. This study tells you the total decay rate. So the rough estimate you can make with this is that you get GF squared delta, which is the difference of mass between the neutron and proton, by 80 pi cubed, and this should be 1 by 87 seconds. The unknown is GF. So from here, you can estimate GF as 1.8 10 to the minus 5 GF squared. Now this is a very crude approximation. There are much more details of this, but it's still not a bad estimate because this is the current value. 1.1 or 1.2, let us say, and you got 1.8, but the order of magnitude everything is correct. So, moreover, the point is that if you use the Fermi in this interaction, current form, you will get the following distribution of the decay width in terms of the energy of the electron. Okay, and you see it goes as E cubed into delta minus E. So if you plot 1 by E cubed, this goes as delta minus E, so that is a straight line. And if you look at this plot, which is called the Curry plot, for the decay of tritium, which is the beta decay, then you see here are the beta points. Okay? And they fall along this straight line. So Fermi's theory was specifically successful in explaining the beta decay. So, a little aside at this point, there were many alternative theories of beta decay at that time, apart from Fermi's. And one of the very nice theories was due to Minda, Saha, and V.S. Kota. And their theory, in some sense, didn't need a neutrino, so it worked very nicely. However, it predicted a different shape for the spectrum. So when the Curry plot was made, Fermi's theory is the one which won out. There were other theories also, none of them succeeded. So that's the evidence of Fermi's theory. Now, the important thing is 1937, the muon was discovered, and it decays to electrons. So what you see is a muon track like this in a curved chamber. Something missing goes out here, and then you get an electron which curves much more, and you get a short track of the electron, which then gets absorbed. Now, the decay must be due to weak interactions. Why? Because you're seeing tracks. As I explained, if you're seeing tracks, it must be a weak decay. And so the muon should go to the electron. There should be neutrino and another neutrino to balance the spin. These are all spin halves. Okay? So, Fermi's guess, it was a guess, but a brilliant guess, that the weak interactions make universal. So instead, you write exactly the same thing as the beta decay graph, but except now it's a muon going to an electron and to neutrinos, same logic. So let's use this to calculate the muon lifetime. To do that, you get this one. And if you plug in the numbers, so now you know GF. So if you plug in GF, you will get to around about 2 microseconds. What is the measured muon lifetime? 2.2 microseconds. So it's spectacular agreement. So we conclude from this study that indeed the weak interactions are universal. They don't depend on whether it's a beta decay or it's beyond decay, they have this universal process. So, great insight. And today we have many more proofs. Interestingly, they could also have written other forms of interaction, right? Instead of gamma mu, you could have put gamma mu, gamma phi, and got an axial vector interaction. Or you could have just put the sigma mu mu's and got a tensor interaction. His idea of choosing the something like the electromagnetization is a stroke of genius, because that is what later led to the Gauss theory. So it was really a stroke of genius to have found out the current form. So, statistics. He actually discovered nuclear fission, but that's another story. And maybe the first nuclear reactor, discovering the original magnetic cosmic rays, the world, you know, as I said, is one of them. Now, there's a problem with Fermi's theory. Okay. It wasn't realized in the beginning, but after some time, people realized that Fermi's theory has a problem. So if you have a vertex like this, neon goes to this. As for then, by universality, since the universal, should also have a possibility of replacing the neutron by the electron. So, two electron goes to another electron and two neutrons. That's also possible. Just replace the neutron by the electron. This is universal across all particles. It should be there. Okay. Now, this means you should have a scattering process where the electron and a neutrino scatter to give another electron and a neutrino. Okay, so instead of keeping it as a decay, it could be a scatter. Well, electron cannot decay into another electron. But you could have a scattering. So calculating the scattering cross section, what you will find is that it depends on this g squared by pi. S, well, S is the center of mass in g squared, minus the variable if you like, 1 minus S is electron squared by S. So what happens when S is large? This term drops out, it is proportional to S. So if you keep increasing the center of mass energy, what happens? The cross section grows and grows. And if the cross section grows very large, what does that mean? The probability also keeps increasing. The probability, of course, cannot increase indefinitely. Maximum probability has to be 1. So at that point, what will happen is that you have broken the law of probability, which you can also express as the unitarity of S matrix. So therefore, S matrix becomes non-unitary, and you could, therefore, you could say that this is a unitarity violation. So that's it. So S is so there is a problem with it. It works only when the energy is low. When you go to high energies, the theory fails. So you could ask, perhaps this arose because we only took this lowest order diagram. There will be higher order diagrams, it's a free theory. So if we include those diagrams, perhaps the behavior will become softer. Perhaps there will be cancellations. Okay, but when you include the higher orders, not only does it not soften the growth, but you get a new problem, which is called anomalism. So we'll have a discussion of that in the morning, but I'll explain it in this context. So let's take this in case. We have this four Fermi coupling, another four Fermi coupling, join them together. So this is the first order correction. So I put in momenta. These are A and B are the initial states. 1 and P1, P2 are the final states. And then K is the loop momentum. And then you get K plus PB going this way. This is GF. So the amplitude for this loop should be the following. So this one is the linear order term. Okay? This is the linear term due to just the four Fermi interaction. Now I add on this term, so this is IZF here squared, okay, by root 2, so that becomes 2. I get an integral of the loop momentum. I have one Fermi propagator, k slash minus AB, and one of the further neutrino, which is much less, so k slash minus AB. Okay. Now, since k is integrated over all values, the dominant contribution will clearly come from k equal to infinity. Remember, there is d4k here. So therefore, as you go to larger values, the interior of the sphere, so the volume of the sphere, the spherical shell is increasing. So you will get your maximum contribution from large values of k. So that enables us to make an approximation. Let me throw away the masses here. Okay. So let me throw away this mass or this moment. I keep only the k slash k. So I write this one over k slash. Everything else is the same. Okay, so k slash is k squared. So I've written that in this case. And this d4k, so now that it only depends on k, you could integrate over the four dimensions, and you write this as k cubed dk. So finally, it's a proportion to k dk. If you integrate limit is n by 2, and the upper limit is infinity. So this becomes divergent at infinity. So if I write it in terms of a cutoff, so if I write in terms of cutoff lambda, then this should I will get here is half lambda squared. So that's why the infinity 2 and lambda squared. The problem is lambda squared is very large. Should be very large. Okay. So what does that mean? That means this is your three-level contribution. This is the one-loop level contribution. This is supposed to be the perturbation contribution. So therefore, if the NLO contribution is much greater than your leading order contribution, then your perturbation theory doesn't make sense. What is the idea of perturbation theory? Which is what you do in finite diagrams. Then you have a leading order which gives you the approximate result. The higher orders will keep fine-tuning this to give a more and more accurate relationship. But if the higher order gives you something much bigger than that, okay, then that should not be. I mean, if you have a dog, that has a tail. If you take away the tail, it's still a dog. Okay. But if you have a tail, and then you take and you add a dog to it, then clearly that's no longer a tail. Okay. So it's like the larger object cannot be the. So there is something. Something's wrong. So of course, such problems also arise in QED. But then the advantage of this divergence is log. So log, of course, is a very slow leader. It doesn't increase by too much. So in fact, when you go to even higher orders, so you will always get logarithmic divergences, you can all add up and then absorb them in some discrete charge of the medicine. So that this process is called renormalization. But for this one, if you keep trying to do it, you get higher and higher powers of lambda. So first one lambda squared, then you get lambda to the fourth. So you keep getting higher order operators and you have to keep all. So you can't do renormalization. But does this mean that the Fermi theory is wrong? In a sense, yes. You get a better theory. But remember, Fermi theory works at lower levels. And now, first we have Bohr's correspondence principle. What does that say? That every new theory should reduce to the old theory in the range of parameters where that theory was successful. So the Fermi theory must be replaced by some theory which, in the low energy limit, reduces to the Fermi theory. So that's what the correspondence principle is. That we have whatever new theory we look for must reduce the Fermi theory in the low energy limit. So this is the point where we get the intermediate vector bosons were introduced by Schwinger in 1958. So the argument which he started with was, see, renormalized is possibly in QED. So can we copy the form of QED for weak interactions? Okay. Let's try to do that. See, that will work there. That's one place where we know it is. So consider the QED bosons. E plus E minus goes to E plus E minus. So that's the diagram, okay? E plus E minus, one diagram, and it's the only diagram in this case. And you have a photon, and it goes to E plus E minus. Okay, here, goes to E plus E minus. Okay, and right on the amplitude, what you have? On this side, you have the electron current in terms of the spinners. On this side, you have the muon current in terms of the spinners. This is the photon propagator inside. And if you like, you can just pull it's a contraction, gamma and gamma here, and IE will spread, then you pull down, and you will have a K spread in the denominator. So this is the form of the electromagnetic interaction. Okay. Replace this by the weak process, where you have electron and neutrino, scatters to muon and muon neutrino, and now instead of this, you have a W boson. So electron neutrino goes to W boson. And the coupling here, instead of, see, earlier it was IE, so I'll put an I small g here. G will be some decoupling constant, replacing the electromagnetic charge. And this amplitude should now be written in terms of this g here and same thing here. Okay, so let's do that. Then what happens? This effectively becomes like a Fermi coupling. This is like a Fermi, current, two currents. So this IG here is the W boson vertex. This here is the W boson propagator. W is the weak boson, W for weak. And all that you've done is taken Fermi's idea step further. So all of this was one point inside that green circle. Was just one point for Fermi. You extended it by putting boson inside. And now your GF over root 2 is this G squared over K squared. Okay. So you found some formula for the Fermi constant. The problem with this is that the Fermi coupling constant does not show significant weight as energy goes to zero. If this is true, then when energy goes to zero, very low energy, what should be? Fermi constant should grow. You should get a bigger and bigger amplitude, but you don't. It's roughly the same. So somehow, this behavior is not shown up. Though this is good, it's like electromagnetism, so it works well. But when you put in this, you get this problem. So what was Schrödinger's solution? Brilliant solution. He simply said, give the W boson a mass.
Yes.
Don't give it massless like a proton, but give it a mass. Now what happens? It's the massless propagator. This is a massive problem. You have k squared minus Lw squared in the denominator. You also have a w. So now you write the same thing, but now you put this mass inside, this propagator. Okay, and for the moment, forget about this stuff. Let's write the g0 and you get k squared minus mw squared, so you get that outside. So now your gf by root 2 is g squared by k squared minus mw squared. What happens at low energies? In low energies, so you get this. This is a constant. The minus sign doesn't matter because you're going to take mod squared anyway. This is the amplitude, so you take mod squared to get the problem. Okay? So, brilliant, right? Just by putting a mass here, at low energies, you've got a constant. But you don't know the g, neither know g nor do you know mw. So you know the ratio of z. Okay. But the intermediate hypothesis works if you have a massive W. Okay. How does this help? In other words, of course, it will solve. But also if you have this, see, we have this diagram, right? So now this point here, this four formula interaction, we are going to replace by putting a W there. So this is electric diagram. You put this, and now you see that instead of these two fermion propagators, you also have two boson propagators. Okay, so when you rewrite the diagram, now there are these two boson propagators. Okay, so in the high energy limit, neglect the W square, but now the k slash will give you k square. That's two more k's. Okay, there's a k square from there, and there are two more k's. K square, you keep the four. So, for the final result, if you have PQ, but that's fine. That will not damage.
Sir,
yes.
The integral has 0 to lambda.
Yes. Yes, but lambda is 1 by lambda square. Which is fine. Lambda becomes large, it's fine.
Sir,
and the bigger lambda is
the lower limit.
Yes. Okay. Yes. The lower limit will the lower limit will actually be regulated by the masses. When k becomes very small, you'll have to take the masses into account. So I have glossed over that.
So by reducing the mass in the W boson, I'm like, shouldn't you be bothered about the others? In which representation you are doing it? I'm like, it should be a spin one, right? Then what about the other? You are just reducing this mass in the W boson, but if it is massive, then what is its spin states and what about the other states? Are you
clear?
Yes,
hang on. Okay, so he has correctly pointed out that actually I have to. Right. So now the point is the other spin states will contribute to these terms. And now if you include these, what happens? I'll have to put the KU, KU also will be the dominant term here, right? At high energies. So now you have 1, 2, 3, 4 Ks. So 4 Ks by 4 Ks. And 1 by K, so you're back to KU. Alright? So I got the right nice result only by cheating. So if, as he points out correctly, if I do it properly, then I'm back to the same problem. I haven't solved anything. So, now this is where the brilliant idea of Schrödinger comes in. He points out that we must get rid of this KU. We can't live with it. Okay, we need only the GMU here. This one must work. Now, he's asked, what does this propagator coupling do? So what did we have here? We have this GMU and GMU. We had IGs, and then on this both sides, we have these two currents, isn't it? J in and J out, right? That is the U bar coming here. Now, this term will go away if KU times JU is 0 or KU times JU is 0. In moment of space, KU, JU, KU, JU, what happens in position space? Del U, JU. Del U is gives you KU in the moment of space. So where did you see del U, JU is 0 yesterday? When you had conservation principle, very beautiful. He comes by steps and shows you that if you want to have a unitary theory, which reduces to Fermi's theory, the low energy limit, you must have a Gates theory. And that's the Gates theory of interactions, which Schwinger himself did not write down. He asked his student, Glashow, to write it down. And so what he did with that, I will discuss in the afternoon.
More questions? We would expect questions from you, right?
Why don't you actually give assignments? Then we will understand whether they have understood.
I will give some assignments, but I'm not sure whether they can be done in this time. But I will give you some assignments. But anyway, you're free to ask me outside or at any other time over lunch or something.
So if there are no more questions, we cut short the coffee break and we meet at 12 o'clock, okay? Yes, thank you.
Rakin, ekটু দেখতে আচ্ছা পরে দেখাবো নে আমি এন পার্টিকেলের জন্য সব রিলেশন বের করে ফেলছি তোর নিউ এর জন্য রিলেশন এটা আগে ছিল ঠিক আছে পরের থেকে দেখ টেন্সর প্রোডাক্ট এন এর জন্য
Thank you.